Dames en heren, afronding van het geheel. Ik moet zeggen dat wat ik voor wij heb zien gaan, is heel interessant. Een hele hoop leuke ideeën. En een aantal zou je kunnen zeggen, dat is te verwachten, maar er zitten ook een aantal bij dat je zegt van nou, dat is toch wel heel aardig. Ik heb zelf even een klein stukje over Utopia opgezet, om u daarmee te belasten. En dan loop ik door de gezamenlijke input van de workshops door. Ik heb geprobeerd uw input een klein beetje te rubriceren, maar in de snelheid en de beperkte tijd valt daar nog wel wat op aan te merken. Maar dat geeft niet. Als u het niet begrijpt, dan steekt u uw hand op en dan praten we er even over. En dan kunnen we het toelichten en komen we wellicht tot een oplossing. En u moet natuurlijk niet vergeten, het geheel wordt natuurlijk ook nog in ons verslag uitgewerkt in Lucifer. En dan kan hij dat nog eens rustig bekijken. Het is wel heel leuk om te kijken dat het woord Utopia uit 1516 vandaan komt. En een vrij lange periode terug.
That's a very long time ago. Thomas More generated the word Utopia, as you heard from Barend. He wasn't happy with the political situation in his time. It was very negative, this period. And he couldn't stand this negativity and darkness. That's why he wrote the book Utopia. And that's why he said, I will write a book about the ideal state, an island somewhere at sea, and we start again.
Heeft u natuurlijk van Barend vanochtend gehoord dat
as you heard this morning,
de afleiding is van niet bestaande plaats of goede, gelukkige plaats of samenleving.
The happy place and living together.
Als je deze beperkingen ziet, deze woorden,
you can ask yourself when you hear these,
universeel moet dat zijn.
How universal this has to be. How far do you want to go in this?
Kan het heel individueel zijn?
Or can this be very individual? Maybe my personal utopia looks very different than someone else's personal utopia.
Maar er zitten een paar interessante toch wel gedachtes.
There's some really important thoughts on these two Latin words.
Dat het heeft ook zoiets van het moet verheven zijn of het is zo groot.
It needs to be so big that actually doesn't even exist.
Aan de andere kant wordt dus eigenlijk dat goed.
And on the other side, you think that good and that happy behavior, it's coupled with that.
Idealisme komt er naar boven.
That there's a certain kind of idealism comes forward, some kind of ideal state.
Aan de andere kant is het ook in onze samenleving natuurlijk best wel verwoord met.
It's also of course.
Het is niet. Het is een utopia.
It's a utopia. It's not possible.
What
you're thinking of is utopic. It's never going to work, of course. That's what people are saying.
Aan de andere kant zit er ook iets.
But on the other side,
moedeloos in. Iets van, nou, dat gaat ons niet lukken.
You know, people just think it's never going to work. It hangs together, these two things. You know, of course, as theosophists, we're very optimistic, and we think this will work. This can happen. But how far do we go in this? Do we need to wait until something happens that it's possible to happen? Can it work now? And when we try to make it work, how's it going to look? Does it need to follow certain norms of the group? Or does it need to be so universal as possible? These are interesting questions that you can think of, and that it's definitely worth thinking about.
Die kan je natuurlijk invullen, materieel gezien.
You can fill the utopia in materialistically.
Wat zijn de materiële omstandigheden die je nodig hebt?
What are the materialistic things that you need?
Mee om te kunnen gaan en met elkaar te kunnen leven.
To live together in a utopia and to be happy.
Voor iedereen een Ferrari?
Is it for everyone a Ferrari?
Wat is het, Trabant of zoiets?
Or some kind of small family car. Just a small car that you keep dry and brings you to A and B, from A to B. Is that what we want in our utopia?
Ja, waar ligt die grens?
Yeah, where's the border?
Nou, is dat helemaal geen nieuw vraagstuk dit?
If this isn't a kind of new question, of course, Plato also wrote, he also solved this problem.
En Plato die zegt eigenlijk in zijn...
Plato says in his book...
In zijn staat...
The state.
Dus eigenlijk, als hij begint, Socrates, het verhaal te schetsen. En dan schetst hij eigenlijk een hele spirituele
how he sketches his story. A whole area where consciousness is...
Zeggen, een leefvorm die we hele determined. Het best kunnen aanduiden zoals je dat in het boeddhisme onder de Sangha terugvindt. Gelijke kleding, gelijk voedsel, gelijke slaapgelegenheden. Op het materieel gebied niets anders wat je
on a material level only what you really need to be able to live in good health. No luxury, you only aim for a spiritual study to communicate the results of the study and this is basically what you want. But the audience of Socrates said, no, guy, no, this is so very basic, this is not what we want, and we want a little bit of this and we want a little bit of that. And then he describes, and that's the state that we know from his book. If there is the question of, and we should allow material possessing for people, from people, then it gets more and more complicated. This part of the book is 50 to 60 pages, and the other hundreds of pages are the consequences of what you need extra when you want to have more than the most basic. So you get different groups in society, different responsibilities, how to secure your possessions, and those people cannot be universal enough, so people aren't then going further to protect their own possessions first, so it gets very, very complicated all in all. So this is not what we're waiting for. If you want to have children, that's decided by the government and by the state itself, so there are lots and lots of elements, and that's not really what we want. So if you reflect a little bit of about such an utopian structure, then you'll notice that in later period, not Thomas and Thomas More period, but in later days when people have taken over these ideas of Thomas More, then you notice that in the anarchistic group of people that utopia is a situation where everyone is equal, where there is no governing state, we share each and everything, there's no one in the lead because no one is able, has the capacity to lead, so there's a total kind of equality and equalness, and you could really doubt would such a system work, because in the Sangha and Buddhism we do have in this community a kind of a structure. You have the abbot who's leading the cloister and the monastery, and you have a very clear spiritual structure in Buddhism to form an inspirational channel and to be able to give a verdict when there is discussion about certain issues or what needs to happen in utopia to rule and govern things. So if you take a closer look to how one should arrange things in a utopia, then this morning we already learned from Marijn that it cannot be carried out in a conventional way. And the idea, it should not be limited in one way or another. And that's very important, because if one says, well, there should be limitations, then from that moment on, there get the divisions. We are in utopia and the rest of the people need to stay out of utopia. And then you have already created a source of complexion and diversity. On the other side, we need to realize ourselves that if we want to set up utopia, that we do not have a perfect working material available. We are human beings with characteristics who are lower and higher personality. And there are only few people in our society who are of those higher level, the spirituality level. And so if we want to set up such a thing, we need to communicate with each other in such a way that a kind of a way of how to cope with each other and how to work and how to accept each other's shortcomings. And we'll give you some examples of this. So if you are supernatural, and if you are aware of your own limitations, and you are, then it's not a problem to work on this if you work in your higher personality. Okay, you may address another and say, okay, if you know better how to do it, then say how you should do this, help me to develop things, and then we can work together on this. Okay, so we are focusing on a certain way on self-education. We, if we want to approach the utopia thought, we need to develop and really to grow our capabilities. And this morning we learned from Barend, we need to be relatively perfect. It's a mental attitude. If you are relatively perfect and you want to realize this perfection, but you realize at the same time that you do not possess this possession at this moment. This perfection at this moment,
and
sorry.
And
what are our capabilities, what are our present mental attitude? If we know that we were able to do a certain, to carry out a certain number of activities in a relatively perfect way, then those things that we are able to carry out in a semi-perfect way, we're able to lay that on the table. So an idealist is a transformer for his environment, but also an inspirator. So in the context of your being limited, you must realize that certain things you can carry out relatively perfect, some elements less, so you're an aid for helping to develop as a transformer the whole situation and inspire things, and let's do it together, let's work together on this, let's our hands out of our sleeves. And if you take a closer look how this is going to function in its totality, then we'll get this title presented from the Taoists, Wu Wei, doing nothing. We translate it very often, so we don't do anything at all. So. And there are other translations saying, like in the Tao Te Ching, acting without acting, and acting in coherence with harmony.
Dat er dus eigenlijk weinig gaat gebeuren als we blijven zitten.
And if we don't do anything, then we know that it's a limited thing. So acting is kind of an element to be able to act in relationship with the greater some, the greater elements. Take for instance a dolphin, something which swims in the ocean. It swims in such a way that it don't causes any swirls. It goes in a very transparent way. A dolphin goes in a very transparent way through the water. So that's an example that you should move in such a way through the totality that you doing things in close harmony with the total system without without disturbing the coherence with the overall environment. That is a real big challenge. And you see that there is a kind of a certain activity needed in the form of self knowledge.
You moet er open voor staan. Je moet dus eigenlijk open staan voor inputs.
To be open for input from other people, you have to be compassionate, you have to trust in yourself and in others. Things we have heard this morning. And if you question yourself, how do you do that in one sentence we have heard this morning about the Bodhisattva ideal? We have knowledge, we have insight, we have developed compassion, but we do not wish to harvest that in a spiritual rest, in nirvana, but we wish to have the knowledge in society, to use it in society. And then we are in individual growth is not of any importance anymore. Totality, harmony is important. We have to try and do that. And then you will have the experience as a side effect and not as a goal. Now we are arriving at input. There are a number of suggestions. We try to list them down in several groups. The element of leadership, going out of peace inside yourself, unity in yourself, acting out of unity, realizing that you're part of the total. Trust in yourself, self-knowledge is very important, relates very much to peace in yourself. Of course you have realized this morning, if you are not in harmony in the morning, you have several encounters and you are disturbing the atmosphere in your office, for instance. In a few moments you have all kind of emotions with other colleagues. With that respect, you have to give a good example. If you are responsible, if you are a leader, you have to be open for it, and you must be an example for others, and you have to be prepared to receive feedback from others. Also, employees from a lower level, they are able to give you feedback, and you have to take that serious and improve yourself, or for improvement of harmony. For that reason, the leader has to be the most universal thinker. If such a leader is a specialist, you have to be, very soon there will be all kind of hobbies and companies develop in certain directions and they will lose contact with society and they are not able to deliver the products society is asking for. Leadership is responsibility. That means that for yourself you can only come to the conclusion that you have to lead if you accept that you take responsibility as well. And out of that responsibility there has to come a stimulus to take an example and direct things. You have to understand, when we talk about leadership, then we talk about, like Lao Tse mentioned it to us, a good leader is walking behind the people and not in front of it. From behind the people, you're more a stimulator than you are leading them by the hand. Employees can have experiences you don't have yourself, and they can be much more of a stimulus than others. You have to listen to other people. There are many examples from corporate society. If the top doesn't know what happens and doesn't listen, then decisions will come out of the top and the basis will not understand and it will not work. The most interesting example from the English railways is one of the directors was told to work together with the workers, and for every certain action, 2 minutes, next 2 minutes, it was very...
Want die treinen moeten eerst goed stilstaan. En het eerste wat hij deed, was het verhogen naar 6 minuten per koppeling. Om gewoon te laten zien van wat gebeurt er. Ik heb het meegemaakt in een bejaardenhuis. Dat de directeur dus verpleegpersoneel dus 's nachts met z'n tweeën liet werken op 300 bewoners. En toen ik vroeg van wanneer is de laatste keer geweest dat je hier 's nachts bent geweest... Ja, ik ben hier s'nachts nog nooit geweest. Ik zei, waarom kom je hier?
He said, I didn't even come at night. Where are you saying I came at night? He tried to come save him at 10:30 at night, and at 6 in the morning he was still busy. And they weren't allowed to use light because of safety aspects.
En ja, toen zag hij natuurlijk wel dat dat dus bijna een ondoenlijke...
And then of course he saw at once that it was an impossible task they were asking. So really you need to know what is going on.
Een aantal hele interessante opmerkingen over groeimogelijkheden.
Some interesting responses onderwijs, about growth possibilities. Making
verantwoordelijkheid nemen.
Responsibility.
Dat zijn dus eigenlijk in het onderwijs zo te zien vrij primaire doelen.
In education, it's primary goals.
Delen,
sharing, living together, taking responsibility.
Dat zijn dus, denk ik, hele aardige elementen.
These are very easy elements.
Ook in de klas. Maar ook denk ik aan naar
also thinking about a thought for the teachers and helping each other.
Beweging van groepen,
migratie,
komen we straks nog even op terug.
Migration.
Als die harmonie er niet is,
if the harmony is not there, in the small or in the big, then there's automatically
the graag van de ene afdeling naar een andere afdeling.
Of course, going from one part of a company to another part of the company, that it's a nicer work environment, and they didn't like the one where they're at. Or you go in a country where it's not very nice, since you move to another country that's better, it's materially or spiritually, doesn't really matter what your reason is. And you give the...
om andere golven te herkennen.
To recognize other waves.
Als je dus een straf ondergaat.
If you get punished in the system.
Is eigenlijk behoefte aan
there's actually a need for education.
Opvoeding.
With
gewoon afzondering.
And not just putting them away.
Met oog om oog, tand om tand.
For the eye for eye, tooth for tooth mentality.
Dan plaatslaten.
That education was very important.
Yeah.
To make people aware of the fact that they had a too small of a vision. So it's a positive vision and how to train them and let them grow. And here's another one, education.
Yeah,
almost the same, your education ability. Awareness of the milieu, of the environment.
Input van te krijgen.
We had thought we would get a lot more input about this environment, and there were only two groups that came back to this. Of course, there's about the green footprint, but the typical environmental question wasn't really discussed a lot. Making a career isn't important. In utopia, there's not a need for a career.
Daar is geen noodzaak voor.
There's no need for it.
Als die utopia harmonisch is,
if the utopia is harmonic,
ontwikkelen en groeien,
then you can grow and develop in your own speed and what you need.
Er is een eerlijke verdeling,
and there's an honest
carrière te willen maken.
So all the desire to make your own career, it's just not necessary. You don't have that desire. If you're happy in your own section and you think that you're able to develop in that area, then why would you want to leave from this part to another one? The economy. I have some interesting things from economy. I'm making what is made goes back to your the people, sharing the wealth. You could ask yourself if in a real utopia if there is any kind of wealth, because wealth is gathering and setting apart. what is belongs to someone else. And if you're in a utopic system, and the system is generating good welfare, then the what is made should be honestly dealt out within the people to their own needs.
Klopt heel aardig. Productie naar echte behoeften. Dan gaan we weer terug naar vroeger.
We're going back to the begin. Production for own need. Like I need a pair of shoes. I need to go to the tailor. I need a new suit. The whole mass of production that happens now. Yeah, it wouldn't happen anymore. People would have perfectly tailored clothes that they needed, what belongs to them, instead of you spending tons of money on a suit. That's actually a question.
Presenteren en werken uit de mens. Dat is een hele interessante. En mijn opvatting is, maar dat is mijn persoonlijke opvatting. Als we kijken, dan zien we natuurlijk best wel dat er een aantal pogingen zijn geweest om een utopia op te zetten. Kijk er maar gewoon even naar het hele gebeuren in de Sovjet-Unie.
Look upon the complete system in the Soviet Union. The question that is more is here. Does equal rewarding get the motivation out of people, the need to produce? And I've worked with people from Russia who said that if I come out of the university, then there were three factories to choose from, three plants, in tractors, in aircraft, or in the military system. So these are my options, and that goes for the next 35 years. And the salary in all three directions are the same. So what was the consequence? People really had no stimulus. One had to conclude that there was nothing like a real important above the personal level system, but there was no extra thing what would be of interest. But why should the secretary of the party decide on my buy of an automobile? I need to wait for 6 to 9 years, and if you are high up in the system like a party secretary, then he had the same car in 2 to 3 months, so there was no equality there. And then you have the same situation if the leader doesn't live up to the is not a living example of how it should be done, then it doesn't work. And you cannot expect that people without any financial idea and incentive that they are not really going to do this. It's not only about saying from the leading perspective, declare the appreciation to people, but you also need a financial person. So the next point, giving and receiving. To one's equality. This is justice. Justice becomes education and works on the Solomon's judgment. And that's not that easy, but it is the idea, the thought. You need to see where the real problem is and the real interest of the case. Now you get some elements on, then you get the idea that if you have the necessary money to hire a high street advocate, then you'll win your case. And second point, giving the opportunity to prisoners to recognize certain ways. Education, not punishment, but more education. Principles instead of rules, that's... principles instead of rules. Okay, if you live by the rules, then people are studying the rules and the text of the rules, and then you have the opportunity that the way things are formulated offer a little maze in the web, and then you have the possibility to bend it left or right, and then you are not in conflict with the system, and justice has no arguments to prosecute you. every fundamental law, basic law has already the system and the basics of a legal system, but you see that in the secondary laws and the bylaws, the rules and regulations are more a kind of semantic exercise and activity. So if you do apply only principles, then you do need to reassess the legal system and the way the laws are formulated. And if the system grows, then it goes without saying that those principles can be applied in a certain way. There's another advantage, big advantage to principles. Hey, who is most advanced will be have the utmost understanding, the best understanding of those principles, and will by his knowledge demonstrate to the very best way how those principles should be lived up to in practice. Lawyers are becoming adepts in the universal law and become teachers, and so you don't need any real present style lawyers anymore, and they are able to transfer those principles to the people. And the judges should be a kind of a Buddha, a thought from the Egyptian Book of the Dead, the Egyptian judge. A judge should be a very highly developed being who, on basis of his insights, doing justice. We had that in the earlier days. In China, for instance, when a judge had made a mistake with the sentence that he had spoken about, that he was going to be subject of that sentence. So if we would apply that at the present day, then judges would be very a little bit more careful with their sentences.
When you are going to put boundaries, but you must realize that in utopia has to be so strong, so spiritual, in balance, that it is capable of attracting and receiving people from outside of this utopia to give them the chance to get schooling there, to be part of it, and that they become part of this utopia. So that these people can carry with the others the idea of utopia. You can imagine that it takes quite some time to realize this. This is not a matter of 1, 2, 3. So in a way, you get a utopic system of training, schooling, to get people in, those who are motivated to get in and be part of the system. Which country does that at the moment? I think very few countries. And the last, physical maintenance. And it strikes me that in the other parts we had a spiritual point of view, and that the physical side, the maintenance, that the instrument is important to give the mental aspect, the spiritual aspect a way to express, but still you need to realize that in utopia, as simple as it would be, like the Sangha in Buddhism, the monastery should somehow keep the roof leak-free, and it has to be cleaned. Kitchens must be cleaned and toilets if you want to have a reasonable community and to be free of illnesses, etc. Of course, I agree with the idea that it's not the highest aim, but it's an aspect that belongs to it. You need to give maintenance to the instrument that that is helping you, that is serving you. So there are some very interesting combination of interesting thoughts, and the question now is, what are we going to do with that? So we really showed that we can generate these ideas, And how are we going to translate this? The 12th of September we get a bit of a challenge. You can choose then in which corner you think your utopia can be given form. And working hard in the society with spreading the ideals to get a group of people that are more open to it. And still, when you look, despite all the ups and downs and problems that we know, that there is a general line in the fact that the common good plays a bigger part. There are people that are not susceptible to it, but there's another movement that talks about a green footprint and harmony in society, and they have ideas to deal with that better. The simple fact to become aware, and I liked it, was an American smartphone, and then you can touch in your smartphone what you want to eat, and you get a message how green your meal is, and how much earth and water it took what you are eating now. And I have the idea that when you have this very strong visual reflection, that you are ready to choose another dessert or another starter. So when we are conscious of what we do and we know what is the result of what we do, then when you walk around at the supermarket, you make a picture of the product and you see a list and you see what it contains, then you might decide not to take it. So there's something happening. But this is movement from the technical side. No, it's not bad if technicians go hand in hand with the idealist. I think we have come to the end of our two-day symposium. I myself have a very good taste impression of it. I'm very happy. Very good public, very good cooperation with our people in the workshops. Very good team, lovely team to work with. And also for the technical challenges, and I can assure you that the technical challenge was quite heavy, quite strong, with all our videos and audio. We made it all ourselves this year for the first time. We did not have a company that helped us, so that's quite an achievement. A little bit of problems with the American contact, but still the delay there was solved. So we are very happy and positive about it, and we look back at a very wonderful 2 days with you. I want to give you some thoughts to close for the closing. Maybe you want to re-see or re-hear what you have heard. So we have a video. We will have a report in Lucifer, our magazine. What's the problem?
Yeah, I get it.
There's a new program.
We have a new program in Kleinburgen for you.
That's ready for you. A very clear color, so that you can see it wherever we put it. And there are some very interesting lectures in it. We start 7 September.
Op 7 September.
In Amsterdam.
De eerste openbare voordracht die we gaan houden. We starten op 19
We start on the 19th of September in The Hague.
We start de cursus anders.
We start a course Thinking Differently on the 5th of October. And now I have the feeling, did I do this right? But if you doubt, please have a look at our internet page. And you know that at the moment there's a lot of video material at the internet. So when you're at the beach with a good Wi-Fi connection and you have the idea, what did he say again? Then have a look at our website and play the video. And you can stop whenever you want. You can turn us, rewind us. You have a lot of control over what we do then here in the hall. So that leaves me to thank you for being there and to wish you a very happy and spiritual summer in which you hopefully have all the time that you heard to work out. And you know, you saw our sheet. If you want to support us, there is an opportunity for that. And we wish you a good holidays. And we would like to see you back in September when our activities in September start in Holland start again. In the meantime, we do a few things in America and Germany. So this summer, we will be active with quite a few people in other countries. Have a good trip home and bye.